What's the title of the show again?
This one?
Yes.
I don't know.
I can't remember.
Four old ladies are still rocking away.
Oh,
with
boring.
The music. Am I making sense? I'll tell you in 2 years' time.
Can you do one that goes da da and ba ba?
Yeah, I'm not a singer.
That's the least of his problems.
I'm not the drummer.
Of course, it's getting nice, this.
I have no plan.
If it's planned, then it's boring.
Well, it's got hidden depths.
What can you say?
Boom. Da da!
Huh? I think that's a sort of surreal masterpiece.
Very musically awful, but totally right.
It's not like rock and roll,
but it is unusual, and you have to buy it.
Then it's okay. When they stop buying our records, then I'll say goodbye and become a strip artist or something.
And luckily, the story went the right way.
Just get on with it. Otherwise, I'll forget my name.
And ask Roger.
No, not a good idea.
I can't remember where the idea did come from. Could have gone the other way.
Oh, shit, all that crap again?
make it.
Somebody!
Ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, Queen.
Great group.
One of the biggest bands on the planet.
That looked great and sounded great.
One of us has been immensely successful.
I kind of got a soft spot for Queen somehow. Freddie's a one-off, you know. You don't get too many people like him.
Queen, that's something really.
They've always approached music very intelligently. Probably because they've all got so many degrees and they're all so well educated and everything.
Brian, good guitar player as well.
He's the governor, you know. He's the best pop type oriented guitar player there is, really.
Sweet guy who is the nicest man in the world.
Everybody loves to play his licks, you know.
Like they should be playing mine, you know.
To me, they fall into the same category as the Stones.
I don't know. Ask me next time and I'll think about that one.
They are totally recognizable.
Giving everything of themselves.
You've got this very trendy drummer, you know, hey, the good-looking drummer.
The man's got a lot of balls, and he's an original.
100% successfully.
It stunned you, the whole group stunned you, first of all, because they look so interesting.
The name fits the band, and it fits Freddie to a T, because the whole thing was so majestic.
Her Majesty.
First album I ever bought was Queen's A Night at the Opera.
Queen is one of those bands that most of us guys growing up in the 70s is one of those bands that you have a tremendous amount of respect for.
I think you can tell, you know, when a band's got musical skill.
And I thought they were brilliant.
They weren't just a rock band, you know, they incorporated lots of different types of music.
Okay, there's a lot of show and there's a lot of camp.
Fantastic theatricality and campness that everybody enjoys.
I think they're great. Seriously.
They're a very, very talented band, and Freddie Mercury is very, very gifted.
Yeah, they had potential. The ugly one, what's his name, who sings? Freddie's a real one-off, and at that time, nobody looked like him. Nobody sang like him with the harmonies and everything.
I like Freddie.
I like his music, but he doesn't turn me on.
Freddie would be very pleased about being called the next Mick Jagger. I don't think he'd really like that.
I think Freddie is very good.
King Mercury?
Oh, I like that Freddie, but he was not a queen, though, but I like him.
For a long time, I think almost all the music I played was Queen. I had a big addiction for a while there.
You've got the classic bass player who's sort of, you know, quiet and very into music.
He's a good bass player, but he should use a heavier bass.
Queen are the biggest in most countries.
So they must be good.
I mean, they make wonderful, pretentious, over-the-top music, but they're fabulous.
What a great gang of guys!
Hi, my name's Kim Bettinger.
All right!
Thank you for fitting the reality to happen today.
Galileo! I'm just a musical prostitute, my dear.
We can always come back to Queen, like coming back to Mother.
I don't want to sleep with you. I don't need the passion to. I don't want a stormy affair to make me feel my life is heading somewhere. All I want is the comfort and care, just to know that my woman gives me sweet mother love. Oh.
Smile.
At the Albert Hall, of course.
Smile.
Smile was really a semi-pro outfit. We hadn't really made the big jump to go professional. I guess we couldn't because we were all still at college. And kind of by hook or by crook, we got this gig at the Albert Hall, which was the bottom of the bill. And we actually got our first review, which was in the Times, and it said something like, the loudest group in the Western world unplugged and left the stage. But they didn't say who it was.
I used to go and see people at the Marquee, see groups at the Marquee, and think, now how do you get to that situation? And the answer was that people want to book you if they've heard of you, if you've made a record or something like that. And how do you get to make records? Well, you get to make records because if you've played at places like the Marquee where people notice you. So how do you get in?
I had gone for a few interviews, audition. They're always rather depressing affairs, you know. You sort of get 80 drum kits in a line.
We got together with Freddie, who hadn't been in Smile, obviously. And Freddie had lots of ideas and lots of enthusiasm, you know. He'd been in groups before and had similar experiences to us, you know, never really got anywhere.
We'd formed Queen before, I mean, I can say this, you know, now, before sort of David Bowie had done anything.
I'm not sure. I'm really not sure.
I mean, you know, there was a long sort of gap between actually forming Queen and actually having a recording contract.
I heard from a friend that they were looking for the bass guitarist to join their group. I got myself introduced to them and said I'd be interested. And so basically I went along for an audition.
I thought after 5 years, you know, it's all going to be over and I've got to sing something else. Become a child lady or something. Liar!
Nobody believes me. Liar! It seems unimaginable what's happened, really.
We felt very strong together. We felt that the strength of the band was in, you know, was in the band.
We had incredible belief in ourselves, you know, I mean, quite blind and ridiculous belief in some ways, but we did have this kind of belief that we could do anything that anyone else could do.
The first time we ever featured any music by Queen on Whistle Test was in July 24th, I think it was, 1973. The track was Keep Yourself Alive, and the actual film that was used was a bit of material that had been used by President Roosevelt for his campaign in the cinema. Keep yourself alive, yeah. Keep yourself alive. We'll take you all your time and the money to make you
survive. We were, I think, among the first people to try and actually put on a proper show, as opposed to kind of go on there and be cool. It was very unfashionable to be like that at the time.
At this point in time, I think if I had long hair and fingernails and wearing the things, I would look ridiculous. I mean, I looked ridiculous then, but it worked. I'll take you to the seven seas.
Freddie, on a typical.
Righto.
You try to be last, but never make it. Yeah. It's always a battle trying to be last here.
When you're recording the album, you tend to think, when you sort of first mix it, etc., you tend to think it's the eighth wonder of the world, which it invariably isn't. But it might be quite good. I mean, I'm sure every artist thinks that. She's a killer, dynamite with a laser beam, to fall
We wanted to do things like play the Rainbow in London, you know, and we had a dim, distant vision of what Madison Square Garden might be like in America, but really no idea of what it was. Third year we achieved most of those things, and then after that everything was a bonus. Everything was something which I never even dreamed about.
We just didn't know what to expect when we got to the airport. Hundreds and hundreds of fans really waiting for us.
I think we all felt a very close relationship with them, because at the time we went it was very new and it was a beginning of Japan sort of coming back into the West.
We're completely overwhelmed by what's happened since we came here. It's never happened to us in any other country in this kind of style. We just felt very honoured and a little bit confused because we couldn't go out and see them and talk to them.
Very visually orientated, which is maybe why it was one of the first countries that really picked up on Queen about 150 years ago.
This is John Deacon from Queen here.
I just finished college and I liked playing music, and I was doing both. I started doing an MSc and playing in the band, and the band took off, so I went with it, you know, and at least they guaranteed to pay us £20 a week, so it seemed worth having a go. And then suddenly it sort of seems to snowball, it takes over your life, and it's carried on ever since.
I was, if anything, an outsider.
I think it was partly my quieter personality of why I actually became a member of the group, because they had a few different bass players before me with the name Queen. I think they had about five or six, and none of them really fitted in. In the early days, I was very quiet, because I felt I was like the new boy in the band, because they'd only been going for 6 months, but they had a few different bass players, and so I joined. And I used to keep very out of it, really, in a way. And the three of them used to argue like mad all the time. And I just used to, you know, and I said, come on, John, why don't you join in? I said, you know, I just didn't want to get involved, really, with arguments.
So when I first joined, really tried not to upstage Brian and Freddie too much.
It's the one thing I actually wish I could do, sing, because then that makes
it would make songwriting so much easier.
Because often it is singers and guitarists that are more outspoken, you know, but behind the scenes, I can be as noisy as anybody else. I think we've all had our fair share of craziness over the years.
I am married and got children as well. So it's a bit of a schizophrenic life in a way, because sometimes you're on the road and it's all hectic, and then sometimes at home it's very different altogether.
I never thought I would still be playing in a band or, you know, recording at this age. You know, when you first join, you think perhaps 5 years, 10 years at the most, when you first start playing music.
If I'd just been, a bass player all my life, you know, with the band, it wouldn't be so satisfying to sit here now and sort of that would have been my input. Because I only consider that as part of what I do. I mean, actually writing songs, having and also being involved in the decision-making processes, you know, or arguments or whatever, is nice. You know, I mean, it really feels that you're part of the, you know, of our own destiny, really.
The record that shares the award for the best British single from 1952 to 1977 is...
Bohemian Rhapsody, gentlemen.
Good call.
There are a few things in my life that I'll never forget from adolescence. And one is hanging out at the airport and watching airplanes land, playing road hockey. When Team Canada beat the Soviet Union in 1972 in a hockey series. And the first time I heard Bohemian Rhapsody.
Caught in a landslide, no escape from reality. Open your eyes, look up to the skies and see.
It started long before we were due to make the record, and Freddie was sitting in his apartment and he said, I've got this idea for a song.
Mama just killed a man.
It was basically like three songs that I wanted to put out, and I just put the three together.
Put a gun against his head, pulled my trigger, now he's dead.
He said he was playing away and he stopped and said, now dears, this is where the opera section comes in.
I see a little silhouette of a man.
Scaramouche, Scaramouche, will you do the bandango?
Thunderbolt and lightning, very, very frightening me.
And it was just going to be, at the time, a little brief interlude of a little bit of, you know, a few little things like Galileo's.
Galileo!
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 I'm just a poor boy and nobody loves me.
When we started doing the opera section properly, it just got longer and longer.
He's just a poor boy from a poor family, sparing his life from this monstrosity.
It had a very big risk factor, yes. A sort of, the radios didn't really like it initially because it was too long, and the record company said, you know, you can't market it that way.
Thunderbolt and lightning, very, very frightening me.
We got hold of a guy called Kenny Everett.
Upcoming is the British Eurovision Violence Contest.
And he listened to it, he says, ah, oh, this is wonderful, this is great, oh, I'd love to play this all the time.
And here, ladies and gentlemen, may I introduce to you, Freddie, good start, Mercury, ladies and gentlemen. Do your stuff, Fred.
And he'd do things like, well, I was out with over at the studios with Queen last night. I've got a copy of the record, but I promised them I would not play them. I promised, oh, I can't help it. Oh, my record, my hand slipped. And he'd put it after the record. He'd play the intro and he'd rip it off again. He'd say, sorry, I can't play this. Over the course of those 2 days, he played the record 14 times.
I was in my brother's Toyota Corolla that had exhaust problems.
Galileo!
Galileo!
And Bohemian Rhapsody came on the radio. And we were like, what the hell is this? I mean, there's like, it's cod opera.
Bismillah. We will not let you go.
And heavy metal. I remember having a stiff neck for 3 weeks from the gang, 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 gang. The record company had put clips of Wayne's World in the video.
Anyway the wind blows doesn't really matter to me.
And I just thought, well, they're going to hate us.
To me.
You know, we've just whizzed on a Picasso. I asked the record company guy, I said, can you just explain to them that, you know, we didn't have anything, I didn't know, and if you're, I'm sorry. And then I got a letter from Queen saying, thank you so much.
Mama.
Hey, thank you for using our song. Thank you for using our song.
Didn't mean to make you cry.
I'm more like, thank you for letting us even touch the hem of your garment.
I hate actually trying to analyze my songs to the full. It's like people still ask me what Bohemian Rhapsody is about, and I say, I don't know.
It wasn't intended to be an epic long song, you know, it was just a song that developed as it did. It sort of grew like most monsters grow. Mama!
Just killed a man.
Put a gun against his head. Pulled my trigger, now he's dead.
Mama, life had just begun, but now I've gone and thrown it all away. Mama,
I don't wanna die. Sometimes wish I'd never been born at all.
Yes, absolutely.
Final Studios, 35th video.
You get rid of the, yeah, that's fine. Just get Freddie to leave that brandy bottle on there.
Here it comes. Yeah, come stand by.
It's a white shot all through.
Four to vocal. Three, two, one.
No, he's late on that.
Just watching the show.
Yeah, that was done in a day and cost about 5,000 quid. And looking back, I just think it couldn't be done there. You couldn't do that.
Knew it was time. It made up.
Okay. Could you ask Freddie to make sure that he thinks about his sync, because he goes well off. The guitar player, what's his name, Brian? Him.
His boss said to him, boy, you'd better
the camera went in there, yeah. Okay, just rock it on the guitar now, we'll go from the top.
I want to ride my bike. bicycle. I want to ride my bike. I want to ride my bicycle. I want to ride it where I like.
They got virtually every model who would pose naked on a bicycle to race in this bicycle race. Bicycle company who loaned us the bicycles for it got all the bicycles back, and they complained to us that they had to change all the bicycle seats after the shoot.
Radio Gaga was written in Los Angeles, I think, when my two-year-old son was listening to the radio, and I thought it was all, he just said, oh, Radio Kaka or something, and I had to agree. And in fact, we never changed the lyric.
Right, sharper, front, right, front, and right, look with the heads, right, hold, come on, sharp now.
Okay, stand by then.
I want it all.
You happy?
I want it all.
When you're happy?
I want it all.
Stand by to go again.
And I want it now.
Music.
All right, that's lunch, everybody.
Adventure seeker on an empty street. Just an alley creeper. Light on his feet, a young fighter screaming with no time for doubt, with the pain and anger, can't see a way out.
That's got to be it.
Now! I wake up, feel just fine. Your face fills my mind.
He's listening to the song, you know, but it had this suggestion of like an express train. And then I think Freddie and I came up with the idea of having a train and calling it the Miracle Express.
If I could only reach you, if I could make you smile, if I could only reach you, that would really be a breakthrough.
We made a very important decision at the beginning of this album, which perhaps we should have made 15 years ago, I don't know. But we said that everything that came out on this album would be credited to the four of us, so it would be written by Queen rather than by Brian, Freddie, Roger or John.
Every drop of rain that falls in Sahara Desert says it all, it's a miracle. Creation's great and small, the Golden Gate and the Taj Mahal, that's a miracle. Last two babies being born, mothers, fathers, dead and gone, it's a miracle.
We prepared for it to be good, but we were still quite shocked and stunned at how good these guys were, the young guys. Fantastic, yeah.
I think it was Freddie's idea to send them out on tour instead of us.
Last two babies being born.
Trying to imitate him, it was so difficult at first, but his moves, if you try and copy his moves, and they do get easier the more you do it, and I mean they're really sort of outrageous moves he does, so I mean I'm an outrageous person, I suppose, so. I don't know, even when I left the set, I was still Freddie Mercury for them 2 days. It was just like, I'd been working as Freddie through the auditions and on the stage. So when I left, you know, it was just like natural that I was still Freddie Mercury.
The one thing we're all waiting for is peace on earth and an end to war. It's a miracle we need, the miracle.
Most of the stuff I do is pretending. It's like acting, you know, so you go on stage and I pretend to be a macho man and all that. And then in my videos, you know, you go through all the different characters and then you're pretending anyway.
It is a very English track. Oscar Wilde meet Led Zeppelin.
While the sun hangs in the sky and the desert has set, while the waves crash in the sea and meet the land.
We decided on a different look for each character of the band. Freddie was Leonardo da Vinci. Brian was Victorian Etchings. John was Picasso. And Roger was Jackson Pollock.
To the end of time. To the end of time. To the end of time.
Hi, I'm Roger Taylor. I was going to be a dentist once, but I think that was really just a way of getting to London, I think. Being a student was cool then. I think I had some marijuana when I was a student. I think that's the first time I remember. I didn't agree with me at all. I couldn't handle it. I still can't. I think I had to go and sit down on a seat in a park because I thought my brain was on fire. And I never liked the stuff, really. I think we grew up in a very liberated time. Maybe some people would say too liberated.
I hate very religious people.
I am an optimist and I always think that the good will sort of come out. Well, I'm not very good at resting, that's the trouble. I have to go and if I'm not down in the downstairs room writing or something, I'm sort of fiddling with things or maybe buying pictures or something.
I find either anger or sadness is a good way to write, I think. Because they're very definite, they're sharply sort of defined emotions.
Pop music and rock music has always been basically fairly trivial, and I think that's great, there's nothing wrong with that. It's difficult to say something without looking as if you're saying, look, I know more than you, I don't know more than the next man.
We don't want to become old, rich and useless.
You don't have to be rich or poor or famous or anything else to be happy, I think. For every up, every little bit of happiness you get, you know, you must probably have a little trough, a little down, and there is a balance, and that's the deal.
No, we're very lucky. We have a very good life. And I couldn't pretend to say that it was, no.
We are musicians. That is what we do. And that's work, you know. And I think it was Noel Coward who said, the thing about work is it's so much more fun than fun. Well, like any job, it has its boring moments, but what else am I going to do? It's a great job being in a band, you know, and this is my life, and this is what I do best. Live with your memories and keep them as memories, and that's great. Forget the bad times, just remember the good ones, and, you know, and hope tomorrow's a good day.
first time we came back to England to do Hyde Park, I remember with great affection.
This is something which we're going to do with the London Philharmonic, but they didn't turn up.
It was a wonderful feeling to go there and see that crowd and get that response.
And the storytellers say, the score brave souls inside. For so many a lonely day, sailed across the Milky Seas.
That was one of the few times I can really remember being nervous. That was a great moment.
I must say, I found the early tours very exciting. Our first American tour, we had a station wagon, and we all got into it, and commercial flights here and there, and sharing rooms and Holiday Inns.
It was all big and it was all new and it was all very exciting.
They were a support act on a tour with a band called Motley Hoople, and I remember thinking, what a bunch of tossers, they'll never make it. I was wrong. The machine of a
dream. When I saw them on stage, then the grand illusion happened. You know, you could actually see that they were going to be huge. You know, but it was a while down as they were developing.
First time we ever played Madison Square Garden in New York was an incredible buzz. You suck my blood like a meat. Heard that was kind of the ultimate place to play for a rock group, and finally we did it.
I think if we were pioneering in the stadium tour business, that was in South America. When I suggested in 1981 that we were going to go and play 5 football stadiums in Argentina, the entire music world thought we were mad.
The first time we played in South America was in Argentina, but we actually went to Brazil first because we were trying to get to play in Brazil.
It's a little hairy when your head of security in São Paulo introduces himself by saying he's killed 206 people.
It was great. You know, a lot of the important people turned out to see us, as well as just the kid. Maradona came down and he actually came on stage with us. I don't know if that's recorded history or not, but he did come on. I think he said hi or something.
Fred Mercury.
Hello.
Vocal e piano. Hi, Fred.
Sit on my left.
Fred, how do you feel playing and singing before 200,000 people?
I haven't done it yet.
The show is going to start right now.
What, right now? We'd like you all to have a really good time. It's like a Queen carnival, so enjoy yourself.
Okay.
Especially South America. When we first sort of made our mark there, that was a high.
It was fantastic, and it was like, I suppose, being the Beatles in North America a few years before, and quite blinding. I mean, it was really much more than we ever expected.
Yeah, I think our music is quite visual. It does lend itself to visual things. It's sort of quite big. It's sort of wide screen, cinema scope.
Has provided any explanation.
We did it in about 4 weeks. We did a little bit of pre-writing, but most of it was done actually to the film. It's for every one of us.
Most of it we actually played watching the film in the old traditional manner, like the orchestras used to do, you know, conducting and watching the thing, and when his hand comes down, comes the bang. So it was exciting, different. It's a kind of magic.
The kind of magic came about through the film Highlander, and it was a line from the film. I thought it was a really strong line. Had a kind of magic about it.
Been alive for 4.5 centuries. I am immortal.
When I came up to doing Highlander, I thought to myself, the film needs a big, not only a big orchestration score, but it needs a big rock score of that anthem type quality. I had 20 minutes of the film cut together, and I brought them in. And I didn't know how they were going to react, and I only wanted them to do one song in the film. And they saw the footage and they said, we'll do 5 songs. Here we are, we're the princes
of the universe. We did only like 5 tracks to go in the film, and then there's about 9 tracks now. Is it 9? Yes, about 8. Yes, about 9 tracks. We've come to be the rulers of your world.
We shot that video using bits of the film, but we sort of integrated the two by using Chris Lambert. And so he sort of is in the film, then he suddenly strolls and he's on stage with us. I have no rival, no man can be my equal. Send me
to the future of you all. The only thing I remember is that we were in the caravan, I mean the van, Freddie's van. And I had to get out of the van because they were playing the music so loud. It was like having a private concert. And it was great. No man could understand. My power
is in my own hands. I find that most actors are frustrated rock and roll stars. I know Chris Lambert is, and John Hurt's told me that loads of times. He's a rocker, really. Most rock and roll stars want to be actors. One man, one goal. One mission, one heart, one soul. Just one solution. The original words actually were about Martin Luther King. Mm-hmm. And now I don't know, I haven't got a clue what it's about. Somebody said it was about Bob Geldof, but I don't think it is. No.
So you don't know what it's about, but it's
no, not anymore. Riveting. Well, they changed all my own words.
Who did?
Like that rotter Freddy. One vision, give me your hand.
had as many failures on the film side as we have had success.
It wasn't even the death of Freddie that gave us a hit there. It was a movie. And it was a great movie, which I loved. I thought it was very funny. But I just thought it was very ironic, you know. It was nothing, you know. So it's completely out of your hands. It was just fate.
Cut! That's a wrap, everybody!
Come on! Nice
they won't come out.
Why are we going now? God, I know it's living, haven't we?
It's an event.
Excitement in the air.
Just coming through the tunnel now.
Adrenaline.
I've always been an audience.
A lot of people out there.
It's a good feeling.
That's a slightly small gig.
But the bigger the better.
Still rocking away.
It's like a big toy.
Punk rock.
We want to be there.
Wonderful moments.
Starting off, it was fashionable to just go on stage in your jeans and be dirty and play and put your head down and never look at the audience, you know, and if the audience has a good time, then fine, you know. And we were a reaction to that. We thought that's not the way, you know. If we have one night in one city, then we want to give ourselves as much as possible. So we will use any device to get closer to those people.
Nobody. Not even the Queen. Not even President Reagan. Nobody!
Not even you.
And not even the Prime Minister of Yugoslavia.
Another party's over, and I'm left cold sober. Baby left me for somebody new. I don't want to talk about it. Want to forget about it. Wanna be intoxicated with that special brew. So come and get me. Let me get in that sinking feeling that says my heart is on an all-time low.
Usually, audiences are pretty good, and you find that nationality doesn't really make any difference. Although you might get in some places, I mean, for instance, in Germany, audiences like to sort of clap along like that.
Thank you.
entertain you. Let me entertain you. Let me entertain you. Come here and see my spot. I'll show you some good merchandise. Pull you or not pull you.
Our show is all us. No, we don't have a director or anything. We choreograph it and we do the lights and we do it all ourselves.
I can't imagine it being really simple because we always like to put on a good show, you know, an overall production that's visual as well as just audio.
Theatre. I mean, I like to sort of, I like to ham it up, you know, I like to sort of really perform a song. I mean, those songs can be performed by somebody else just sitting down, but I mean, they wouldn't have the same effect.
Freddie, especially as a frontman, we had somebody who can deal and who could actually communicate with the back row of a Wembley or where whatever.
Yeah.
want to be entertained in various ways. And the one way I know they don't want to be entertained is for people to just come on and play their songs. Because they can hear it on the record and go home. About a little boy in his band. Time where we were doing tours so extensively, because I mean we would go into a studio, make an album, and then tour the world, and then we'd go back, and that was the routine. I mean, I didn't have any time to actually break away, and we virtually did that for about 8 or 9 years. This is a song written by Roger Taylor, and it's called I'm in Love with My Car.
South America, audiences like to sing a lot with you, and in England also. Whereas in America, in Central America, in the US, they don't like to sing at all, but they just like to dance, you know. So there are sort of cultural differences like that, but they all just like to enjoy themselves in different ways, really.
Esta canção é para vocês. Pessoal de São Paulo.
Once you're on tour, I like to get on and do it. I don't like to be hanging around on tour. I like to get in as much as you can, cover the ground and do as well as you can, because you can build up this great rhythm and you get into the mood and the feel of playing and you play better each night, I think. I suppose it's almost like being an athlete. You just work on yourself and you have nothing else to think about except doing your bit for that 2 hours as well as you can.
Now, so they're very in tune, each territory as well, in tune with what other people are doing in terms of how to participate. That's why we found that when we went to Brazil, even though they don't speak English, they know what to do because they've seen videos and things.
Love of my life, don't be rude. You've stolen my love, you not deserve.
Do Love of My Life, they know that they have to sing it. And it's amazing to watch that I don't even have to tell them, they just automatically know their role.
You forget how many people are out there, and then suddenly when it's a quiet part in the set where Freddie's perhaps doing one of those vocal things with the audience, you know, you suddenly realise, wow, there's a lot of people out there.
Yeah.
You know, it's like boys with toys, because you have the opportunity to do whatever you want on that stage, you know, and we have the best people, the best technicians, and we say, we want this to happen here and this to happen there, and they say, okay, we find a way.
I go through tours where I'm halfway through, I think, oh God, I want to get off. But the moment I leave, you know, I just want to come back on again, yeah. I'm a trooper.
In Budapest, down the Danube on by hydrofoil.
How many bedrooms?
Not enough.
Do they have enough servants' quarters? Interview? Oh, don't be ridiculous.
Right, now you've got to keep this side clear. Just keep this side.
Hundreds of people waiting to meet us, and they were very, very friendly. We had a wonderful time in Budapest, and I think that everybody that came to the NEP Stadium enjoyed themselves. They certainly seemed to.
Vasisel iseth aras viragon viragon in den moda tashot valos viragon viragon
me, I'm Brian May. My mum says I wanted to be a surgeon, but I don't remember that. I was a bit restricted because my parents were very much of the idea that you shouldn't do too much going out, you should stay home and do your homework and you should get your academic stuff right, and then when you're about 20 years old, then perhaps you can go out into the world, you know. So I was a bit too sheltered, really. Yeah, astronomy is much more fun when you're not an astronomer, I can tell you. Because when I was an astronomer, most of the time was spent either making equipment or making it work or setting it up or else typing away at computers to try and analyse the results. The amount of time where you actually look at what you're doing is very small. Because I was a very insecure young boy, probably because I was a bit sheltered, you know. And whenever I did go out to those things, I used to think, my God, I don't know what to do, I don't know what to wear, I don't know who I am, you know. It's a very, very nervous young boy. I'm a clog wearer. I know my talents and I know what I've done. I also know my limitations. So I think there's a perspective that I've learned to keep. There's a balance. Success in rock and roll is something which I think is unparalleled in any other walk of life because it is always fun and it's always different. I don't think that there's anything I would swap it for. I'm a guitar player. I love playing, yeah, always do. And I always come back from doing different stuff thinking, God, I really want to play the guitar, you know. I made my guitar with my father about 25 years ago and it still accompanies me everywhere I go. The guitar was my weapon and my shield to hide behind. Sometimes the brain is connected to the fingers and sometimes not, you know. Sometimes it's, you think, what happened, you know. Sometimes the fingers do what they want to do instead of what I want them to do. I suppose I'm a very self-motivated person and I feel the same motivating forces as I did when we began. I think that the music is incredibly worth making on its own and that's what makes me want to do it. I have an instinctive distrust of politicians because they do deal in these vast numbers all the time. Somebody has to do it, I grant that, it's just not me, you know. I prefer to be either at home, in my house, digging the garden, or else on the road. I jealously guard the time with my kids because it tends to get eroded from all points. Partly it's for them because I think they deserve a proper chunk of me. Partly I know it's for me because they're part of me.
As you're looking back on the documentaries of us and stuff, I have strange feelings, you know. I look at myself, you know, this thin young guy with all this hair, you know, wondering what on earth he was trying to prove. None of us will ever be the same, obviously, because of all that happened. I have to say that I'm proud of most of what came out, though. I'm proud of the music, you know. I'm not necessarily proud of what I've been or anything. As far as my personal feelings, I want to use what happened to us as a starting point for the rest of my life.
Chegaram os conjuntos Iron Maiden e Whitesnake. Agora vocês vão acompanhar a chegada do conjunto Queen. Aí está, o conjunto Queen chegando ao Rock in Rio. Quem?
O que você conhece do Rio e o que você espera desse festival?
Yeah. Well, hello Gloria.
Hello.
Hello. Fred, it's true that the song I Want to Break Free is dedicated for the gay world.
No, not at all, not at all. That song, to start off with, that song was written by John Deacon, you know, and well, he's a very happily married man, you know, with about four children. I don't think where you got that message from. It's got nothing to do with gay people at all. It's basically about everybody. It's just somebody who has a very tough life and he just wants to break free from whatever problems he's got. It's got nothing to do with the gay thing. Besides, it's not my song anyway. John wrote it.
É verdade que a música I Want to Break Free é dedicada ao mundo gay?
And I told you about that. See, I'm helping you out. Next question.
has been the leader of the band. It's
I'm
difficult.
I'm not the leader of the band, by the way.
No?
Yeah, everybody calls me the leader of the band. I'm just the lead singer.
Okay,
and no, there's no such thing. I'm not the general or anything. We're all four equal people, four members, and they seem to call me the leader of the band, but I'm just the lead vocalist.
Difícil, né, ser líder do Queen? Quer dizer, você tem problemas de relacionamento com os quatro por ser o líder do grupo?
This time, I am the leader of the group, yes.
Best song.
Questions up.
You have a surprise for the Brazilian people and the Rock and Rio Festival?
The festival, yeah, it's me. I am the surprise.
Okay, it's possible, a little demonstration?
I mean, what? A demonstration? You want a demonstration? Are you mad? You want me to give a demonstration? Come here, I'll show you. See, it's much better in Portuguese, isn't it? I can understand you, see? No, because I knew what you said before.
Toca!
Speak it again, Rock Rubija. Keen.
Introduce yourself to the audience. Who are you?
Hello, I am John Deacon, the bass player from Queen.
And I'm Roger Taylor, the drummer from Queen.
Perfect.
네.
클린도 봤는데 좀 더 배운 다음에 얘기를 하겠노라고 주변 친구들이 그렇게 얘기를 하더라고요.
네.
Why did you name your group as Queen?
Always a difficult question because okay, so long ago I can't remember. But it was a short, simple name that people in a lot of countries would understand.
What he was trying to say is, ladies and gentlemen, here is Queen.
I think it took us so long. I mean, we had a very steady climb through the 70s in America, and it probably peaking in about the very early 80s, in 1980, and that was probably our absolute peak in America then.
Pressure, pushing down on me, pressing down on you, no man is full.
And really, when we became less popular in America through the 80s, we hardly noticed, because in fact we were spending most of our time outside America. I think Live Aid was probably our favourite day.
Live Aid was Freddie's moment, you know. He definitely pulled something special out of that crowd. I guess we helped, you know. But more than anything, it was Freddie, I think. You have to give him that.
Yeah, do it!
It makes me personally proud to sort of be part of it.
They understood the idea exactly, that it was a global jukebox, as I described it. They just did one hit after another, just going one into it, and it was just unbelievable. And it's time for the hammer to fall.
He was very, you know, animated and very good performer, and worked the audience very well. So yes, they were an ideal stadium rock band, and enjoyed doing things on a grand scale.
The bigger the better, in everything.
I was just really happy that the Nebworth show happened the way it did, because it was never planned on the tour to start off with. you know, Wembley was supposed to be the last show, etc. And, you know, Wembley went so fast and we couldn't get another Wembley. So I went to the band and said, look, you know, what about doing Nebworth? And they said, well, can you guarantee it's going to sell out? Or I said, yeah, it'll sell out. Famous last words. And it did. Radio was new.
They've sold more than 80 million albums, they've played before more than 6 million people, and they've had 16 consecutive hits. Ladies and gentlemen, of course, the top band of the 80s are Queen.
I've been delegated by the boys to say a couple of words. I'd just like to say, after all these years, contrary to what you may think, we do very much appreciate that you still appreciate us. And we hope to be performing some more miracles for you very soon in 1990 and beyond. Thank you very much.
There's probably disagreement within the band as to how much one enjoyed oneself on the road. And then gradually, of course, Freddie's health got to a stage that touring was out of the question anyway. So that was really why no touring took place after 86.
Thank you.
No, I
you
like can you stroke
stage?
Him, yeah?
Should we get a bit of madness in the short lads?
Yes, should we have the other one there?
What's he doing?
Roger, what did you do?
And the outside temperature rises. And the meaning is oh so clear. 1,001 yellow daffodils begin to dance in front of you, oh dear.
I'm coming to sit down here next to Roger, who's sitting here. So Roger, sit here.
Roger. I'm going slightly mad. I'm going slightly mad. It finally happened.
It happened. Oh, yes, like that. Okay, yeah. And then you can just sit down.
Finally happened. Finally happened.
It's a sort of storyboard for that one.
Right.
Once we get it, and do whatever you want.
I'm going slightly mad. I'm going slightly mad. It finally happened. Oh yes, it finally happened.
The character was a good piece of camouflage at the same time as being this sort of slightly leerish, slightly no coward type of humour in it. And the sort of wild-haired character with the heavy makeup and the black and white all did help to hide the fact that Freddie was in fact pretty ill at that point.
I'm slightly mad, just very slightly mad.
have it. End of session. Sometimes I get to feeling I was back in the old days, long ago, when we were kids, when we were young. Things seemed so perfect, you know. The days were endless, we were crazy, we were young. The sun was always shining, we just lived for fun. Sometimes it seems like lately, I just don't know. The rest of my life's been just a show.
So with Days of Our Lives, there are lots of things in there which to us looking at it now are completely about Freddie saying goodbye in a way.
Those were the days of our life. Yeah. Bad things in life were so few. Those days are all gone now, but one thing's still true.
I would imagine that that was probably going through his mind, you know, this is a nice line to go out on.
I still love you. I still love you.
Feel very lucky that we had those fantastic times.
We were together for most of my adult life, you know, since I was not much more than 20, I was doing stuff with Freddie, and it's really like losing a brother.
The 45-year-old lead singer of Queen died peacefully at his home in London.
Fans and friends in paying tribute to the singer Freddie Mercury, who died late last night from AIDS.
At midnight, it was announced that Freddie Mercury had died peacefully at his London home.
Dedicated to their lead singer, Freddie Mercury, who died last night of AIDS.
He died on Sunday after revealing that he was suffering from AIDS.
45-year-old Queen singer who died yesterday, a bronchial pneumonia brought on by AIDS.
His spokesman said he died peacefully last night at his West London home.
Meanwhile, fans from across the country are expected to come here to Freddie Mercury's home to pay their tributes to a man regarded as one of the best in the business.
After he died, I did all the arrangements for it, for the funeral, because we'd spent so many years making him look presentable before he left the house. You know, making sure that Freddie's tie was straight, making sure he looked so good, that it was the last thing that I could do for his last leaving, was just to make everything as perfect as possibly could.
Take my breath away.
C'est la vie.
I'm a very loving person, you know. How about that?
Look into my eyes and you'll see I'm the only one. You've captured my love, stolen my heart, changed my life.
If I had to do it all over again, yes, why not? Why not? I do it slightly differently.
Every time you make a move, you destroy my mind. And the way you touch, I lose control and shiver deep inside. You take my breath away.
Roger has been working very hard, and Roger has a special announcement to make.
Yeah, we hope that a lot of you will be able to join us on April the 20th at Wembley Stadium for a celebration of Freddie's life and career. A lot of friends are coming, and you're all welcome.
It started off so well. Said we made a perfect pair. Years of care and loyalty were nothing but a sham, it seems. Years we lie, we lived the lie. I love you till I die.
My sort of thought was to do something that would achieve two aims at once and try and get some good out of the situation.
It's not Queen. I don't think it's Queen. It's the three of us and a lot of other people combining to do something with the Queen catalogue. And more specifically, you know, angled towards Freddie's part of it, you know.
This particular point, I think it's... I think by now so many of us have actually had friends, or maybe in some cases members of families have been struck down by it. And I think this is as well as probably the most, just the greatest place to create an explosion of awareness for this particular situation.
A building down, splits a family in two, puts people on streets.
Playing with Queen was awesome, getting up there and playing together. The reason that we were there and the whole benefit, and even though it, you know, a result of such a tragic thing that happened with Freddie, it made such a difference to the whole rock and roll audience, because I think that was one of the main things we tried to ignore, was the AIDS thing. And it really brought everybody together, and there was a really wonderful vibe between us and the whole audience. We'll be right back.
He was a sweet guy, yeah, great voice. And a tribute and testament to him, which a lot of people won't click and understand on the day, is that a lot of people are changing the keys to these songs because they just can't do a Freddie.
It should be a celebration. Freddie wouldn't have wanted it any other way, I'm sure.
It's going to be a very emotional day for them, an emotional day for the audience and the people who are singing these songs, but for the band, it's kind of like the end, closing a chapter of a book, so they're going to feel very, very strange, I think. I feel for them today.
Who wants to live forever?
My actual first choice was Who Wants to Live Forever, you know, because it was in a film, Highlander, right? And I remember when I first heard it, it was one of the few songs that brought tears to my eyes. It's a really emotional song. And so I thought, oh, I'd love to sing that. But then I tried to sing it and I thought, Jesus, I can't sing this. Do you know if it's going to be the end of my career?
Should we try it then?
Said, darling, Wembley Stadium, are you sure it's big enough?
Like others we have lost to AIDS, died before his time.
Each morning I get up, can't let me stand on my feet. Take a look in the mirror and I cry. Lord, what are you doing to me? I spent all my years in believing you, but I just can't handle the relief. Lord, somebody.
I think of Freddie, I think of everything that he gave me in terms of craft, and just to sing those songs was especially somebody to love, with really an outrageous feeling. Probably the proudest moment for me of my career, because it was me living out a childhood fantasy, I suppose.
Made some great records.
Alarming lapses of taste.
But musically, they're so good.
They meant everything to me.
It's a perfect band, really.
It represents that whole spirit of rock and roll.
Very majestic.
Most important figures in rock and roll.
Molto preciso.
It's extraordinary.
Very godlike.
A true love for music.
Mad as a hatter.
Real rock stars.
Bring something into people's lives.
It's awesome.
Great voice.
Fabulous.
Look. Extravagances.
That's pretty outrageous.
These guys can be around forever.
Living life to the full.
If there is such a thing as ever.
Pure champions.
Working with these other people, I know for a fact that Freddie would have been excited to be working with him. You know, and he, if he's looking on up there, you know, I know that he's into it. I know he's excited. I know he's up.
There would only be one short period of time in which the time would be right. And the time would be right for two reasons. One, for Freddie, and two, would be to, in effect, to capitalise on his death and to make some, bring some good out of it by creating a greater awareness of the AIDS danger.
People who had organised the concert wanted to have more control on what happened to the money that was made from the concert. And so we founded the Mercury Phoenix Trust in the summer, just after the tribute concert. We have funded mainly charities that have projects that help the people who are suffering directly. Sing your soul. When we go back home, we feel lonely, but when we come together, we feel at home, because we dance, discuss and enjoy ourselves. Why don't we come together and we sing our soul?
I just say on behalf of John and Roger and the trustees of the Freddie Trust, you know, this is something that we all totally believe in. It's something unique in the world, and we're very proud to be able to be involved and to help out.
In all, I would say that Queen has been responsible for over £3.5 million of money going to AIDS help. Delilah. Delilah.
Hello, my name is Freddie Mercury.
The way I look at myself, if I ever do this, is I'm a man of extremes. If I didn't do this, I don't have anything to do. You know, I can't cook. I'm not very good at being a housewife.
I'm very disorganized at times. I'm organized at times, and I'm just me.
I can't relax in bed all day and just do nothing. I think that's a waste of time. I hardly read books, you know. I think that's a waste of time. Well, people are going to kill me for this. I have to be doing something every day. I want to earn my keep. I don't wake up every morning and say, oh, look, have I dried up, you know. He's looking after me.
I don't give a shit what people say about me.
But I hate writing lyrics anyway, because I'm not a poet. I wish somebody else could do it. Mind you, but I'm not like that. I like to do it all myself anyway. I'm a greedy bitch.
I hate doing the same things again. I like to see what's happening now and try and sort of incorporate all those kind of forms into Queen. We all have our ups and downs, and we all have our limitations, and we all know that there are certain things you can't do. But I mean, I don't want some asshole critic to tell me that.
And I want to do it my, you know, my way. I sound like Frank Sinatra.
I think every character is made up of a load of ingredients, and I just think I have a very soft side and a very hard side. On stage, I'm very strong. Nobody can get me. That's when I'm very powerful. But when I'm off stage, I can be very soft. So if the right person gets me, they'll find me that I'm very vulnerable and I can be a real baby.
I'm not worried about sort of making mistakes and things like that. I think I'm too old for that.
I don't regret any of the things I did. I mean, what did you look like 10 years ago?
I think in the end, being natural and being actually genuine is what wins. I hope that comes out in my songs. So please don't go.
one was about 500 and this one is 2000.
Welcome to Southport, the Queen's 10th year convention.
Don't stop me, don't stop me, don't stop me.
Hey, hey, hey!
Don't stop me, don't stop me. Ooh, ooh, ooh.
I like
don't stop
it.
Me, don't stop me.
Have a good time, good time.
Don't stop me, don't stop me.
Oh.
Our fan club members start at the age of like 4 or 5 when they're tiny, but at the moment we've got a huge amount of teenagers that you would think would like the young pop bands of today, but they're all getting into Queen again.
We will rock you.
Our activities range from the aerobic sessions that were going on this morning, hundreds of people doing this awful fitness stuff. We've got football that goes on here, we've got It's a Knockout later today, just silly games, lots of water and custard pies. We have a fancy dress.
My name's Lawrence Holland, I'm 26. I usually dress up every year. When he died, it was like losing a friend. It was really weird, and I suppose that's why I like dressing up, because for me it's like, I don't know, it's like it's keeping him alive in a way. Slightly mad, he wore quite a lot of heavy makeup, and it's quite tricky to try and get that right, and the right colour and everything, and also the wig, because he wore a wig in that video, so it's quite sort of difficult to sort of get that as well. But I think, keep your fingers crossed, it should all look good tonight.
I'm going slightly mad. I'm going slightly mad.
We had a run of songs which became sports anthems.
We are the champions. We are the champions.
It's lovely to hear that We Are the Champions is a song that's been taken up by football fans, because that's a winner's song. I can't believe that somebody else hasn't written another song to take it over, you know?
A lot of our biggest success has been stuff which brings people together. It's related to that feeling you get at football matches, I think. But the difference is that in a rock concert, everyone's on the same side, which is rather nice.
The thing that was really unusual about these last songs that they recorded here was that Freddie insisted on doing a final vocal. Normally he always wanted to wait until all the music was completed before he would put his final vocal on. There must have been a reason for this. I think he felt that there wasn't enough time to have it completed in time. Which also means that he definitely wanted these things to be released. There was no other reason why he would have done that.
I don't want to sleep with you. I don't need the passion to. I don't want a stormy affair to make me feel my life is heading somewhere.
Freddie, I think, when he first came here, thought it was probably the most boring place on earth.
Yeah, that's right.
And it's funny how gradually, over the next 12 years, Freddie himself fell in love with Montreux and began to appreciate the real special charm of this place.
This could be heaven forever. This could be heaven. This could be heaven. This could be heaven. In these days of cool reflection, you come to me and everything seems alright.
By the time we were doing these other tracks after Innuendo,
We'd had the discussion and we knew that we were totally on borrowed time because Freddie had been told that he wouldn't even make it to that point. So our plan was just go in there whenever Freddie felt well enough. We just lived there for a while, so we were always at the end of a phone. Freddie would say, I can come in today for a few hours. And what we would do would be just make the best use we could of him. You know, that's what he asked. He said, you know, just get me to sing anything you can, you know, write me anything and I'll sing it and I'll give you as much material as I can.
Too much love will kill you every time. I'm just the shadow of the man I used to be. And it seems like there's no way out of this ball. I used to bring you sunshine. Now all I ever do is bring you down.
And of course you never knew what was going to be the last bit. You never knew. You just did another bit and another bit and another bit. And we had some great times. We really did.
The night's drawing. There's a silky moon up in the sky. Yeah, children are fantasizing. Grown-ups are standing by. What a super feeling. Am I dreaming? Am I dreaming? Whoa, 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 whoa. So quiet and peaceful, tranquil and blissful. There's a kind of magic in the air. What a truly magnificent view. A breathtaking scene.
The dreams of the world in the palm of.
You're the last person I'm talking to, so you probably get the best interview, darling, don't you?
I don't want to change the world.
To me, happiness is the most important thing. And if I'm happy, then it shows in my work.
In the end, all the mistakes and all the excuses are down to me. I'd like to feel that I'm just being my honest self. And as far as I'm concerned, I mean, I just want to pack in as much of life and fun, having a good time, as much as I can within the years I have. Well, there you are, you have it on tape. Use it. Well, that's the nearest I've come to a lot of passion in terms of interviews. How much more have you got now? Come on, I'm getting bored.
I've paid my dues. Time after time, I've done my sentence, but committed no crime. And bad mistakes, I've made a few. I've had my shelf and kicked in my bed, but I've come through.
And I need to go home. My bows and my curtain call.
and fame and fortune and everything that goes with it. I thank you all, but it's been no bed of roses.